For my first lathe project, I attempted to thread a bolt. I learned a lot about the lathe, but also about Tim and myself. Tim likes to make up little songs as we go.
Need a wrench, need a wrench.
And I like to make up dance moves and noises. Zoom, zoom, zoom. But to start out, we needed to put the material into the lathe and secure it with the chuck.
So we're gonna make a screw out of this piece of aluminum.
Yep.
Clamp down on it.
All three move at the same time.
Then we put the cutting tool in and used a level to decide what height that we needed so the cutting tool was actually going to go into the material.
Swoop.
There you go. Ready for your change. Yeah, that's a little tight. Just a little tap. All right, now notice how see how that's way high right now?
Yeah.
So you're going to loosen it up. Yep, and you want it at level or slightly below. It's high, it can't cut. Ready to just use the lathe for the first time.
Yeah, let's use the lathe.
To cut the aluminum to the length that I wanted for the bolt, I used a crossfeed hand wheel to move the cutting tool across the lathe. There's a dial on this that shows you how far you're moving into the part. For this cut, I just turned the hand wheel until the entire end of the aluminum rod came off, but for later cuts, the depth is gonna really matter. Next, just to get a feel for the lathe, Tim had me surface by hand. So first I used the crossfeed wheel to move the cutting tool just slightly into the part, and then I used the traverse wheel to move the cutting tool along the length of the part. When we're rotating the traverse wheel, it's engaging with the rack gear. And this whole carriage with the cutting tool on it is moving down the length of the lathe along a rack. You saw that I'm not very good at keeping a steady pace when rotating the hand wheel, and my movements are kind of jerky. This is why to do the actual surfacing, we want to use a power feed, and we can engage the power feed of the lathe with a clutch. And this clutch is going to interact with a worm gear that is keyed so it rotates along with the lead screw. And the lead screw is driven by motors back of the headstock, and the lead screw is the length of the entire bed. And the worm gear and the lead screw are locked together and always rotating. And the power from them is only transferred when the clutch is engaged. And this clutch can transfer power either in the crossfeed direction or in the traverse direction. And it's gonna matter which gears the clutch is engaged with. And the top position of this lever selector is gonna engage the longitudinal gears. And the bottom position is going to engage the crossfeed gears. And the middle position is neutral. This is the one that we were gonna need for threading, but that's much later. First, we have to see what surfacing looks like with power feed. And we need to do this until the metal on the outside of the aluminum is taken off enough that we get the outer diameter that we want for our bolt.
So this one you see is pretty shiny and stuff. It's a nice cut.
Are you saying that my cut wasn't good enough, Tim?
Yeah, 3/8 inch diameter. And you got right here, just by chance, you have 0.37.
Not by chance.
5.
That's why I messed up so many times in the beginning, because I knew I had to keep going in. Now that I have surfacing perfected to the right distance, I'm gonna learn how to thread.
What did you read about threading?
Nothing. That was chapter 7. I got to chapter 2.
Now that we have the proper outer diameter for our bolt, we need to make a few changes to our lathe before we can start threading. We've been running in front gear this whole time, which means the motors are going a lot faster. We need to engage back gear to slow down in order to be able to thread.
So I pull out this thing, and this disengages that, and then I have this deal, and pull it towards me further than I think.
That's good.
So if I spin, then the back thing spins. The back.
Yep, and you can see how much faster that spins.
The headstock is moving this aluminum at a certain rate, but we also have the cutting tool that we want to move down the length of the part using the lead screw. And to make sure that the lead screw is moving the cutting tool at the proper speed, we can use two selectors to change the gear ratios. And that way we'll have the proper threads per inch for our bolt.
And we're at E and we need to go to C. Right? So okay, so.
Maybe I should have told you to turn the lead screw a little bit when you were stuck. Turn the lead screw and then the gear teeth will engage.
How do I turn the lead screw?
Just grab it and turn it.
Voila!
For the lead screw to actually move the cutting tool down the length of the bed, we need to engage power feed, but we're not gonna use the clutch. We're gonna have the selector in the neutral position, and instead, we're gonna use the threading lever. This is also known as the half nut lever, because there are two half nuts that engage and go around the lead screw. And this is gonna either pull the carriage down towards the headstock or away from the headstock, depending on if the lead screw is in forward or reverse.
So this is what you're gonna feel, so right there, when this comes around, you might feel it.
Feel this?
Yeah, it's a pull up.
Okay.
A thread dial indicator is also engaged with the lead screw, and this is going to tell us where the lead screw is in its rotation during threading. And then we can pull up on the thread lever when we get to the proper indicator on the dial, and that's going to make sure that our threads are all lined up.
We need better noises like ka-chunk, ka-chunk.
Tim's method for threading is a little bit unusual. He flips the cutting tool upside down, and then he puts the motor in reverse. The cutting tool is going to go from the headstock towards the tailstock. And he says this method is great because if the tool grabs the part, instead of the tool being pulled down and that breaking or the part breaking, it's going to lift up and then the bolt won't be damaged. But before we get to threading, we're going to need to start a little pilot hole so we have the same starting position every single time.
To exaggerate that, let's say it's really grabs, it's going to lift the tool up like this, and we're not going to damage our piece. We want a little valley, kind of a groove, and then we can put the tool head in, we can capture our
starting point. Okay, tighten, tap, tighten and tap.
I changed from the cutting tool for the pilot hole to the threading cutting tool. And then I covered the part itself in blue marker. That way we would see where the threads were showing up.
Triangle of death, found it. This is the thread tool. Wait, why are there so many sides to it?
So you can use it three different times.
Oh, tap, tighten and tap, tighten and tap.
Sweet. The worst that happened.
I'm gonna try on two. You didn't finish your worst that happened sentence.
And after our first pass, we celebrated by finally eating dinner. And during dinner, Tim looked up the depth that we needed for our threads on easybusinessfinance.net, which I don't think I recommend.
Look what I did. And I gotta use this dial. And we start at zero when we're against the part. And then I have to go 76 thousandths in. And that's gonna give us the thread that we need, I hope.
The gear selectors picked how many threads per inch, but the depth of those threads is up to us. So to get the depth, we're gonna move the cross feed a little bit in and engage the thread power feed. And then the cutting tool is going to go from the headstock to the tailstock because of Tim's method, and it's gonna remove that depth of material. And we only remove a little bit at a time, and there are many passes that we had to do. And with each pass, we put the cutting tool a little bit further into the part. And our first pass after dinner didn't go so well. First of all, we went in forward instead of reverse.
Stop.
We went the wrong way.
Why don't we test that?
This meant that the cutting tool moved towards the headstock instead of away, and I thought it would be safest if I disengaged the belt from the motor when we went to dinner, and this meant that everything had shifted and we lost our proper starting point. So the second pass didn't line up with the first one, but luckily these were the first initial passes and it was a very shallow depth, so it was going to work out in the end.
Oh. Shouldn't undo this when you're doing threading.
Like I said earlier, we move the cutting tool's depth in just small amounts at a time, and instead of showing you all the passes, I have several clips together in the next segment.
And to take shape, it's getting more and more pointy. Starting like this, gonna end like this.
We finally got to the 76,000th thread depth, but the nut wasn't going on. So we continued to increase the depth, and we also did spring passes. And spring passes, when you go back over the threads at the same exact depth that you already did, and you might get out any material that you didn't get in the first pass. Tim and I tried to keep each other's hopes up for each final pass that we did.
It kind of goes on. This could be it.
No good. It's getting there. Do another one out there. I think we'll have it. Going out there.
Still tight. Doesn't go on.
I hope it threads on.
Again. Closer.
Maybe another 3,000. That's it.
It's going to be the final pass. Hopefully the final pass.
I'm sure it'll fit. All these final passes. Perfect. Doesn't fit. Keep going.
I hope this is it.
What's wrong with this thing?
Final time.
So close.
We're so close. We're so close. So I thought an hour ago. But I think really this time. This and one more spring pass. That's all we need. It's not made it this far before.
Almost.
Machining takes longer than I thought. EasyBusinessFinance.net might not have the most accurate thread chart.
I'm pretty sure it's like a robot site.
Well, this robot doesn't know how to measure. Just saying. Yes! It did it. It went all the way. Finally.
No, I'm Tim.
Do.
Nice.
It works.
Why did it take so long, and why didn't it work at 76 thousandths? Maybe we looked up the wrong depth, but also Tim's bed isn't exactly perfect. The far side is a little bit higher than the near side, and this is why it seemed to be so close but wasn't quite working. So in the last few passes, we would push down on the far side, and we hoped to get a more even depth all the way around the bolt. I know I learned a lot from this process, and I hope that you did too. So what would you like to see us lathe in the future?
And then we build a robot. You ready?
I was singing what?
But I do see a problem with our screw slash bolt here. We've just made a thread.
We don't need any way to get it into a bolt.
That's lesson two.